part of the promise of your Son, that where two or three are gathered together in his name, he is with them. Through this holy Eucharist we celebrate, make us worthy to sit at his table in the kingdom of heaven. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Everything is a lot better than it necessarily looks. She's doing fine that way,
but they're worried that one of these small, tiny bones in her right hand may have been, fractured. They don't know because it's too small to tell. But anyway, so her right hand is now in a cast. And so she is playing the organ today, casted. She's a cast member for our service today. So, having probably told you more than you even needed to know, I invite you now to join us as we celebrate this Holy Mass on this 26th Sunday of Ordinary Time. And please let us begin today's Mass as we begin all good things. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I will go to the altar of God.
God has joined my soul.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, sometimes our readings are full of good news. Sometimes they abound in hard warnings. Today we are warned that we need to be attentive to the opportunities around us to serve others. It's easy to postpone for another day the steps we need to take. Trusting in God's ultimate mercy is only half the story. Today it may be the only time we have to respond. Keeping that in mind, let us now confess our sins to God, bringing to mind those ways in which we've separated ourselves from the love of our Lord by any sins that we may have committed since our last confessions, and let us confess them at this time. Please say with me now the second form of the Creed. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, in the presence of the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my fault, by my own great fault. That our prayers may go with them, that the food may truly be a blessing to those who are in need in our community, and that they may know that our cathedral parish is reaching out to the community and is open on more than just 1 hour on a Sunday. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you with his authority vested in me. I do absolve you from all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, you will again renew us.
And people will rejoice in you.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let
the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Take our sins away from us, Lord, so we may enter the Holy of Holies with purified hearts through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord protects the stranger, sustains the orphan and the widow, but thwarts the way of the wicked.
The Lord shall reign forever, with God's side
in
all generations. Hallelujah.
Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. And now let us rise and let us give glory.
Shall be done away with. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
seek after integrity, piety, faith, love, steadfastness, and a gentle spirit. Fight the good fight of faith. Take firm hold of the everlasting life to which you were called when, in the presence of many witnesses, you made your noble profession of faith. Before God, who gives life to all, and before Christ Jesus, who in bearing witness made his noble profession before Pontius Pilate, I charge you to keep God's command without blame or reproach until our Lord Jesus Christ shall appear. This appearance God will bring to pass as his chosen time. He is the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality and who dwells in inapproachable light, whom no human being has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and everlasting rule. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, please, one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a beautiful, fresh, crisp morning outside. It's beautiful. It's the kind of day that makes you want to shout and sing. So let's say it loudly. We are looking today at a very famous gospel, Lazarus and the Rich Man. The end of the gospel reading is sort of an obvious turn back to the fact that Jesus died and rose again from the dead, and there were many who would not believe him, because Father Abraham says to the rich man, he says, you know, they have the prophets. They have Moses and the prophets, the teachings of Moses and the prophets that speak to the fact that we are called to care for our brothers. And Jesus emphasized that when he said, the way that you treat the least of my brothers, you treat me. And then to that, the rich man says, but if they see this poor man, and if they see that he's made it into heaven, then they'll believe him. And then, of course, Abraham, Jesus, through the parable, says, if they didn't believe Abraham and the prophets, they're not going to believe if somebody rises from the dead. It's true today. It's very, very true today. When we consider the teaching of the church, the teaching that most of Americans, you know, though, except for those who are of other faiths, but the largest faith, I believe, still in the United States is the Christian faith. And yet, we don't see the faith that people were taught as children and reared in. We don't see that exhibited very well in our communities, and we certainly don't see that exhibited very well by the presence of our faithful in churches. But today will be a good example of it after the Mass, when we share from our own bounty, if you will, with food that will be given out to those who are in need in our community. It's a wonderful thing to do. It is the call that we have in discipleship to Christ. But I also would like to speak to you today about the fact that we are called by our Lord to imitate him, not only in the richness of his generosity and the bounty that he shares with all of us, but we are supposed to be like him because in the prayer, the opening prayer, we ask God to help us to be faithful in our stewardship. Stewardship is the way that we take care of what belongs to God. Because everything that we have, everything in creation, everything that we have, even individually as people and collectively as a church, it still all belongs to God, because God provided it. God made it possible for us to have what we have, because he created all that we are and all that we possess. It's all God's. And we are called to be faithful in our stewardship, so that in earning, we may be just, and in spending, honorable. So that means that when in our earning, how we work, how we labor, that we have to be fair in our work. We shouldn't, even if the opportunity presents itself, to take a shortcut and maybe spend 10 or 15 minutes not doing that which we are called to do, by virtue of the work that we are assigned, whether we're accountants or teachers or priests or housewives or house husbands or students, we're all called to do our very best, so that we may be just in our earnings, that which we derive from the work that we do, and then be honorable in our spending, so that it's not only about me, myself, and I, but it's also about others. The church, the scripture tells us in the Old Testament that it's honorable to tithe, to give 10% of your earnings back to the church or back to God, if you will, to charity. Now, that's a standard, but it's a standard that can always be given, be overcome. You're not limited to 10% just because that's what scripture says. I'll give my 10%, I'm good, I keep the rest of the 90. No, you give what is honorable, you give what is good, and so that the blessings that God has shared with us may be then shared with others, so that the body of Christ itself may grow. And it says, may we not, in our prayer, this is a prayer that we offer to begin to this Mass today. It says, may we not seek our own indulgence, but your glory and the good of others. So we're not supposed to seek, as Christians, we're asking God to give us the strength and the courage not to seek just what we want, not to look at what's best for us, but also what gives God greater glory. And the glory that God receives is the way we treat and care for others. Because again, Jesus did say, the way you treat these, the least of my brethren, you treat me. So there's a lesson to be learned here. Also, it's interesting because in the second reading, which sometimes complements, sometimes it doesn't, the first reading in the Gospel, in the second reading today, from the Old Testament book of the prophet Amos, we hear these words, woe to the complacent in Zion. Woe to the complacent. Jesus said it another way. He said, woe to you who are sitting on a fence. You're neither hot nor cold. You're lukewarm. And because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. You're not going to be blessed because you're like the fellow who says, Master, you gave me 1,000 talents, and I knew you were a hard master, and I knew that you earned where you didn't sow, and so I went and I buried 1,000. I'm giving it all back to you. And this servant thought that he accomplished something by giving back 1,000 that he had been given. And we all know the end of that story. He ends up being cursed, and his 1,000 is given to the one who earned 10,000, or who doubled the 10,000, and he receives nothing. And he's banished because he's lukewarm. He's neither hot nor cold. And many people today are just that. They see a need and they're lukewarm. They say, yeah, this is probably something I should support. Maybe at the next paycheck, I'll be able to help with that. And by the time of the next paycheck, it's all forgotten. And nothing gets done. In this reading from Amos, he says, woe to the complacent of Zion. He says, he continues, lying upon beds of ivory. Now, ivory, even today, it's illegal to harvest ivory, but ivory is still something, you know, an item of value. And here, God is saying through Amos to the Jewish people, lying upon beds of ivory. What a scene, an example, because most of the people are laying on rock or on dirt. And here they're laying on beds of ivory, stretched comfortably on their couches. And then they not only eat sheep or goats or cows, they're eating lambs and calves. They're eating the children. They're eating the babies of the animals that they're supposed to care for. And we know, for example, even today, meat that is a veal is more expensive than beef, and so forth. And It says, they drink wine from bowls and anoint themselves with the best oils, yet are not made ill by the collapse of Joseph. The collapse of Joseph is the collapse of the kingdom, the collapse of Israel all around them. They see what's going on. They see how everything is falling apart, that they have bad kings, that the nation is falling, and it will eventually be taken into captivity in Babylon, and the people who have the best of everything ignore it. And then he says, therefore now, they shall be the first, these people lying in beds of ivory, they're going to be the first to go into exile, and their wanton revelry shall be done away with. God is not easy on those who are complacent. God is not easy on those who sit on the fence. God calls us to make a decision one way or the other, and he's hoping that everybody by our free will commit to him and live the kind of life that he calls us to live. But it's our option. It's our decision because of our free will. So I think the message of today's gospel, of today's Mass, is choose for God. Choose the way that God gives us and shows us. Do the kind of things that are going to be done after the Mass today. Give from your abundance so that others may have. Bless those who have less than us, and be good in your conduct as Christians. Demonstrate your Christianity in the way you live each and every day, each and every moment. Let Christ, let your family, let others, let them see Christ as they look at you so that they may be blessed and the kingdom of God may grow. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now let us rise and let us together proclaim the faith that we share. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified on the cross of Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he arose again, in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again. Judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge my baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life.
acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Amen. Lord our God, accept this gift, these gifts of praise and thanksgiving, which we offer you for your great mercies already afforded us. Let us be thankful for what you have given us and make us mindful of the needs of others. We ask this in the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
And to make it pleasing to yourself,
so that it may be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. The day before his suffering and death, in order to manifest his infinite love to his disciples, and through them to all who believe in him, to fill the hearts of his followers with the fire of his love, draw them to himself, make them joyful, and save them, he instituted these holy mysteries in which spiritually and bodily, in his entire being, he again lives among his people. At that solemn moment, so sacred for the whole human family, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you. He blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Therefore, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son, our Lord, in his blessed Passion, Resurrection, and his glorious Ascension, we, your servants and faithful people, offer to your divine majesty from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to regard these offerings with favor and joy, and accept them as you receive the gifts of your just servant Abel, the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and that which your high priest Melchizedek offered you, a holy sacrifice and immaculate host. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, command that this offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your high altar, into the presence of your divine majesty, that we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and sleep in peace. We especially remember all the deceased members of the Polish National Union of America. To these souls, Lord, and all the rest in Christ, we pray a place of refreshment, light, and peace, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Thank you.
by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, and also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our day, supported by the help of your mercy, may we be always free from sin and secure from all disturbance, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May this commingling and consecration of the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ help us to receive it to everlasting life. Amen. Shall I return to the Lord for the graces he has given to me? I will take the chalice of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise I will call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul to everlasting life. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Body of the Lord Christ.
Lord, what we have received with our lips, may we understand with our minds, and may this temporal gift become for us an everlasting healing. May your body, which I have received, and your blood, which I have drunk, cling to my innermost being, and grant that no sin remain in me, whom these holy sacraments have nourished, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Injure not the poor, because they are poor, nor crush the needy at the gate, for the Lord will defend their cause and will plunder the lives of those who plunder them. Peace be with you. Let us pray. Compassionate Lord Jesus, give us who have received your body and blood the grace to see you in all who are poor, and to always be ready to love and serve them for your sake. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effected myself and all those who I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord. May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And again, I remind all of you that you are invited to the cake and coffee and more that will be provided by our local spring branch on this point of Sunday. Also at 10:30, we will be distributing the bags outside of the cathedral steps, outside of the cathedral doors, to anybody in our community until they are gone. We invite you to be a part of our distribution if you would like. And then after that, then we will be shredding cabbage. And we hope that we'll have helpers to stay so that we can begin this first day of our preparation of the cabbage pierogi. Thank you for your coming, for being with us today. I remind you that tomorrow afternoon I will be leaving to travel to Scranton, Pennsylvania for a meeting of the Doctrine Commission of the Church, and I will be returning on Wednesday evening. Karen, if you would.